First things first, welcome everyone. This is the first episode of our Open Education Café, which we hope will be a series of meetings with open education champions. My name is Agata Morka. I am communication specialist for Spark Europe. And it is my great pleasure to have with me today three open education experts. And the reason why we gathered here today is, first of all, open education. Second of all, coffee. So we will speak about open education while having coffee. So I see that there are some people also in the audience who have their coffee cups. That's great. Cheers to everyone. So let's start the conversation. This series will evolve around the UNESCO recommendation on open education, on open education resources. And I think that you are all quite familiar with this document. But what we would like to do is to dive a little bit deeper into five areas of action that are stated in this document. So five areas of action or five objectives. And today we're going to talk about the first one, which is to cite building capacity of stakeholders to create, access, reuse, adapt, and redistribute open educational resources. So this is what the recommendation is about. And of course, absolutely, I think that we will all agree here that in theory, it's a great idea. But what I would like to hear from our guests today is, how do we go from theory to practice? And before we dive deeper in the discussion, I just wanted to tell you who our guests here are. I will start with whom I see first on my screen. And first on my screen is Jacques. So welcome, Jacques. So we have Jacques Dang, who's secretary of the board of directors from the L'Université Numérique in Paris, France. And I believe that Jacques today is in Paris, speaking to us from Paris. Exactly. Okay, next I have on my screen Chrissi. So Dr. Chrissi Nerantzi, who's reader in Academic CPD from Manchester Metropolitan University in the UK. But Chrissi is not in the UK today. Chrissi, where are you? I can't hear you. I think that you are either muted or something is, yeah, you're muted. You have to unmute yourself.
I'm definitely muted. I apologize. Yes. Hello, everybody. I'm Chrissi and I'm in Corfu, as you can see in the background.
Absolutely fantastic. Thank you, Chrissi. And then we have Robert. So Professor Robert Schuwer, professor in open educational resources from Fontys University of Applied Sciences from the Netherlands. Welcome, Robert. And where are you today? Where are you speaking to us from?
Well, I'm from a very small village, Malden. It's in near Nijmegen. Nijmegen is close to the German border. For people familiar with Germany, the nearest somewhat larger city in Germany is Kleve. It's about 20-25 kilometers from us.
Absolutely fantastic. And I can see that in the audience, we also have people from all over the world. I can see that there is one person from Groningen, if my pronunciation is somewhat correct here. So please also feel free to tell us in the chat where you are joining us from. It's always nice to see where everyone is from. And as you can see, some of us have coffee places as our backgrounds, virtual backgrounds, to add to the atmosphere of us all sitting in a coffee place. Unfortunately, we cannot do it in person, but at least virtually we can. So off we go. I think that to start us a little bit, and also to get to know you, our speakers here, a little bit better, I would like you to shortly introduce yourselves and tell me what it is that you're working on right now. What are the projects that you are the most proud of at the moment? Chrissi, can I start with you?
Yes, and I'm not muted this time.
You're not muted. We okay, can hear you.
No, I'm not muted. Okay, I work on a number of projects. I think you already hear that I'm a reader in Academic CPD at Manchester Metropolitan University in the United Kingdom. And among others, I've set up a series of open initiatives over the years that have been sustained for for a long time, mainly for academics and other professionals who teach in higher education, but also for students increasingly. And one of them is the International Community Creativity for Learning in Higher Education, or short Creative HE, that involves 14 colleagues from different institutions in the UK and other countries. At the moment, I'm very excited, and Paola is smiling and is actually with us. I'm working on a project with Paola Corti on a contribution which is unconventional, and we are not going to say a lot about this, but it was Paola's idea, contributing to the project led by Laura and Catherine, Higher Education for Good, where we make a proposal on how we can make it happen. I'm also part, I was part of QAA project, Quality Assurance Agency here in the UK, a project that led to some very interesting findings around the perceptions of learning of students who are from ethnically diverse backgrounds in the UK during the pandemic. And this is leading us now to further creating resources, open education resources, to help academics to enable students, but also academics, to get away from that inwards looking perceptions of learning and teaching and feel more connected with the outside world and harness the opportunities that open education also brings. And I stop here because there needs to be time for everybody else. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chrissi. Robert, would you like to go next?
Yes. I'm currently working on several research projects, and it's concerning because that's what I'm for my chair is looking at the adoption of OER, and I'm currently most specifically interested in the role communities are playing into this, and especially the role of communities in making it sustainable. Because what you see is that that there are a lot of initial grants available from institutes, but also from national programs. For instance, here in the Netherlands, we have a national stimulation program for many years already, where the government is giving seed money to do an experiment with sharing OER. But when this seed money is ended, then the trick is how to continue and how to make it sustainable. And we are and one project I'm particularly proud of to be involved with is a project where 17 institutions of higher education in the Netherlands offering a bachelor nursing program are already 5 years working together to make that sustainable. And they have decided to go on another 5 years without project money, but for their own account, to make that happen, to have a more widespread effect. And this project is especially a very worthwhile topic to investigate also. And that's what I'm doing currently together with Marion Baas. Chrissi, you know Marion, I guess. She's also from GoGN. And Marion is doing this study as cases for her PhD study. And that's one part. The other part of what I'm currently involved in is a national program on it's called the Acceleration of Educational Innovation with ICT. It's a Dutch national program. It's now in its fourth and final year. And one of the projects within it is is towards open, but open between brackets, education resources. So we are developing tools and instruments and documents to help institutions further to in adoption of OER, but also in working together for making better use of digital learning materials, and on all levels. So both aimed at the teachers, support staff, but also on management and boards of universities in the Netherlands. So that's currently what I'm involved in.
Jacques, how about you?
Well, I work at the French Digital University and I'm in charge of international relations and cooperation. So we've been doing a lot of work in two specific areas. I'll be talking about is the homophone world in higher education and also the relationships with the business world. So we involved, we've launched an initiative with UNESCO and ICBE just a few days before March 2020, before the pandemic, about building capacity for stakeholders in French-speaking Africa. French-speaking Africa has something that some specificities. It's, well, it has a heritage of French centralized civil administration, civil law, top-down approaches, no spoils system in the civil administration, and a vision which is more about common interest than perhaps ICT in Anglophone African countries such as Kenya, where it is a market and technology opportunity. So that's it's an opportunity for us to work with virtual and traditional universities as well as Ministry of Higher Education, for which we have deployed, for whom we have deployed a number of what they call pedagogical continuity platforms, sharing open educational resources for these countries such as Congo or Senegal or other countries. So that's one aspect. And the other aspect is working with an ICBE project, Erasmus Plus, which, and we're involved as associate partners with building relationships with the business world. So in this area of open education, we are stretching the boundaries. In the first initiative, we're working with a lot of civil servants, because if you want to change IPR rules, you have to work with UN agencies in Geneva, World International Property Organization, World Trade Organizations, in order to build a consensus with all the member countries. And we're also stretching the boundaries because we are going to deal with open education, but also deal with businessmen. So this is something that is interesting and it allows to enforce the capacity, the competencies of our higher education partners in Francophone Africa and also as well in some European countries.
Okay, I think that that one thing is for sure, that you have lots of projects that you're, all of you that you're engaged in that have to do with open education. I wanted to ask specifically, because we are here to talk about this first area of action, so capacity building. What does it mean to you and how do you relate to this first area of action in your own work? Have you been working specifically to somehow accelerate capacity building? And if so, how are you doing this? How do you go from this theoretical approach to something more tangible, which has some results? And before we start, if I can just add, of course, the audience is more than welcome to participate in the discussion. If you have any questions, then please just raise your hand, unmute yourself, go ahead. There are not that many of us here, so please feel free to also ask questions to our experts here. So coming back, how do we go from this wonderfully formulated theoretical idea to something which actually has is translated into reality?
Who starts?
Whoever wants to start.
Okay, I'm going to make a start.
Go for it, Chrissi, yes.
Okay, and as Agata said, please contribute either through the microphone or in the chat as well to ask questions, to share your experiences as well, experiences and any ideas you also have, because they're all valuable. That's why we are all here. Okay, so in my role as an academic developer, I feel that it's very important to model practices, to introduce open seamlessly in our teacher programs, if you like, or educators programs, and I do that in my institution. Beyond that, I think we can do it through collaborative projects, again, with an ethos of open, and I've done this regularly, and I can see that this has an impact on spreading the love, I think, for open and the value I think, of open. And the last one, I'm going to connect with what Robert said earlier about communities. And how he talked about how to sustain communities, and it would be interesting to discuss that maybe later on. But I think communities itself can also help in building that capacity.
Yeah, I agree with that, Chrissi. That's our experience, that in this research, especially on this community for bachelor nursing, one of the values the teachers have formulated is especially the value of learning from each other, getting inspired by others, and then also telling that to your colleagues. Because this is I've experienced it as a very complex matter to how to enlarge adoption, and how to adoption where capacity building is one of the elements you have to take care of, because it starts with raising awareness among teachers, among every stakeholder, also management, boards of institutions, also raising awareness about what are OER, what can it be for you, what can it mean for you, what's in it for you, because the what's in it for me question, that's in sometimes very hard to answer. When everything is going right, why should I be involved in OER? It costs me a lot of time. I don't know what I will gain from it. I'm very busy as a have a high workload as a teacher, and mostly teacher/researcher, where unfortunately sometimes research is more valued than teaching. So you have to be very clear on this answer. And I like the approach you mentioned, Chrissi, about start with where their passion is, and that's education. That's so it's not a tool looking for a problem to solve. No, it is starting with the main process, and the main process is education, and analyze from there where OER can add value. And for me, the answer is in this more generic term, open pedagogy.
I fully agree with what Christine and Robert have said. And in my personal view, capacity building is about community. That's what you said, Christine, and it's about awareness. In my specific area, it's about removing stumbling blocks. Let's say I'll take one of them. Most of the academics in Francophone countries are civil servants. So I need to deal with the Ministry for Civil Administration in order to remove any difficulties related to the state ownership of content produced by academics, because that could be something that would prevent academics from participating in. I need to deal with the Ministry for Higher Education, as you said, Robert, so that teaching is rewarded as well as research. And that's something that is important. And it's also bridging the gap and understanding between different communities. In France, we have people who have developed Jitsi, which is an open source software, which is widely used. But we also have proprietary software that is used by Airbus and Boeing for building aircraft. That's a 4.3 billion business, that's with 16,000 staff. So I need to have the people dealing with open source software to be willing to discuss with the people who are in the proprietary software business. So relate with what is done in the open, whatever, source, open science, open education era with the coexisting business world. So that's one of my main challenges also. But I think it fully relates to what you've said about community and raising awareness among communities.
Can I ask a question for Rob, maybe, and Jack?
Absolutely. Go ahead, Chrissi. Yes.
Yes. I mean, Robert, you mentioned something about time, isn't it? The time factor. And we hear that very often. Oh, I don't have time for this. You know, I'm so busy, etc. What do you answer? How do you deal with this? How do you try to convince them?
Well, one time I don't think they are looking for excuses when they say I don't have time. Another is we don't have a policy, but that's another argument teachers use to not be involved in open education resources. We don't have a policy. I'm not so sure if I'm allowed to, and all those kinds of things. When teachers find out, so what I'm doing is talking with teachers. They have an issue, issues, a stumbling block, preventing them from giving what I name their perfect lesson. Every teacher has a picture of a perfect lesson which they which gives them energy and which makes them very happy when they go home. But there are some issues in preventing them from giving this perfect lecture. And from that point, I can analyze, okay, how can open help you in clearing those stumbling blocks, those barriers? And when they see that works, and when they see then I'm helped, then they have time. Because maybe time should be replaced by priority. So their priority is giving the perfect lesson. And when I help them with openness make them actually that they can give this perfect lesson, then they are happy, and then they are also ready to learn about all this boring stuff like Creative Commons licenses and so on.
I will join Robert, and I think he said it very well. They said our teachers are very much focused on their perfect course. For some of them, it's a work of art. So yeah. Copyright and IPR are secondary. What they're doing is very important. And I will say what Robert said in a more Mediterranean way, hopefully both Latin and Hellenic. I'd say it's about sharing passion about what you are doing. We are all at different stages of our academic career. We all have different goals sometimes, but when you can share your passion about teaching, about doing a work of art, about sharing what you love, I think time is somewhat less important. And that's what we can bring in our colleagues when they're ready at the correct time in their career, share the passion.
That's just lovely to hear. I think both of you, the argument about time for or against time, if you like, and sharing that passion. I think all our colleagues, or all of us, all educators are also interested, I think, to make a difference to our students, isn't it? And if they can make that difference using open approaches so that they feel more connected, I think that's often the driver for innovation that research has shown anyway.
But Chrissi, do you also, when you talk with teachers, you could also get this time argument, and how are you reacting to that?
Yes, I mean, we often do hear that colleagues are overwhelmed with work. And I think the last 2 years, especially, where they had to learn and unlearn and relearn so many things, moving fully online and getting used to working and teaching and facilitating learning in that space. I think it has been a real challenge. But what they have learned is they have learned to work smarter. It's not about doing more, it's actually doing less. And I think if we see that also as a strategy to build capacity in open, I think that's a valuable tool. How they can do less, how they can harness what's already out there, how can they connect with communities that are out there, how can they as educators benefit for their professional development, but also how can their own students benefit to feel more connected? Because one thing we hear a lot is that students felt lonely the last 2 years, and they do talk a lot about I had no friends. They feel very much alone in that process, and that's not nice to hear. So open can solve, like you said, Robert, many of the problems. And I think if we present open in that light, I think it makes it more attractive.
But you said it right. Open can solve many of the problems, but not all. Open is not a universal medicine or a cure for every problem. And I think it was Rory McGreal who once said, why should I defend being involved with open? Why has the commercial learning materials and being involved with commercial learning materials, people don't ask, do you have time for it? Or people don't ask why, is it worth it? What's in it for me? Why is that? So that's a question which I don't have an answer on it, other than maybe it should be a mixture of both worlds. Last year, I spoke with David Wiley. Well, we all know David Wiley as one of the gurus in the open world. And he also said, oh, the open education resources is not for 100% covering all the topics you would like. And so you need to make a combination of both. And that's actually what we have done in the Netherlands in this innovation program, which I've talked about in my introduction, that all the institutes for higher education and SURF, which is a cooperative association of Dutch educational and research institutions for digital services, they've signed a declaration in which they commit in working together to regain control over digital learning materials. So they want to get in discussion with publishers to talk about the conditions. And those conditions should be so that there could also be the conditions on the data which is left behind on the platforms of the commercial educators or commercial publishers, because commercial publishers are doing an excellent job. But it should be under the control and under the conditions of the institutions and not under their conditions. And then, when they do an excellent job, they can be paid for that. And that is something where all the institutions in Netherlands have recently, last month, signed a declaration with a focus on 2035. So it is we see that this is a very tedious and hard topic to crack.
If I can jump in, because we have an interesting question coming from the audience, which has to do with the question of time also that we were discussing here. So Jonathan, would you, it's a question from you. Would you like to just unmute yourself and just speak to this, or would you prefer me to read out the question?
I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, go for it. It's much more human this way. Yes.
Hi, everyone. I was just wondering, there are lots of discussions about the time investment people need to make. And it seems like the time, I mean, I often, when I get asked the question about time, I say, don't do the OER work today if you don't have time. But the next time the commercial publisher makes a new edition of some topic like calculus, which has been around for hundreds of years, and they require you to rebuild your course because the book is a new edition, at that time, do the work. And it may not be all that much additional work that you have to do at that point, except for things about CC licensing and maybe learning some open platform where you can edit and so on and share your work. I was just wondering if any of your program, your countries or institutions are building training about those basic tools for open into programs for grad students or future teachers, because that will then make the time investment in at some future date to make this transition much easier and much shorter.
Well, on my part, we participated in an interesting project with the OER Foundation in New Zealand, because we have adapted for our target audience in Francophone countries, civil servants and governing bodies of higher education institutions, one of the learning in the digital age courses, which is about open licenses, copyright, which was a triple charge, a linguistic one, a cultural one, and a legal one, because we were, in a way, adapting something that came from a common law framework to a civil law framework. And if I can quote Rory McGreal saying that course, there's no relationship between copyright and intellectual property rights, except that in civil law countries, authors' rights are a subdivision of intellectual property rights. So UNESCO translated the course, which actually we did the cultural adaptation, we did the legal adaptation, and we have transferred that to the Virtual University of Senegal, and we're going to transfer that to the Virtual University of Côte d'Ivoire in order for them to have national seminars with their academics, with their support services in universities. So it's not a huge thing, but it's something that can be helpful, and it's something that comes back to how do we get from theory to practice. We do small steps at a time, and the next step will be a wider curriculum, this time targeted more at civil servants in higher administration, and also building on content that has been devised in the US by SPARC. So I think building all the on the existing contribution, doing small steps, one step at a time, is something that can grasp the attention of the audience and to make them empowered with it. So I think that's one way we have done it. There are probably other ways to do it.
Well, I can talk about from the Dutch perspective. We in the Netherlands, we have a very active library cooperation from university libraries, which they have a working group on open online education, and they are creating those courses and lib guides for working with OER and more broadly digital literacy courses. They have shared as open educational resources. To quote another one, another Dutchman, Willem van Valkenburg from TU Delft, he once said, creating and sharing open education resources is teamwork. It should not be the only a teacher being involved with it, but it should be a team of people, education technology, the ICT specialist when you have more advanced digital learning materials, the copyright expert, the person adding the metadata and publishing it on a platform, which is also mostly done by librarians. They should together form a team and together create and share and update those OERs. And I fully agree with that. But that also means that capacity building should not only be targeted at teachers, but also on the support staff. They should also know about the nitty-gritty details of OER.
Absolutely, I agree that there are different stakeholders in this ecosystem, and we should not forget about any of them. Actually, Jacques, there is speaking about different stakeholders in this ecosystem, because I have a question from the audience for you specifically, which is, what capacity needs to be built among the business world?
Something that has perhaps been done already for the open source software is that they can make a business building on open educational resources, improving them. And we do have a number of companies, edtech companies that are working out in Africa. They are making contracts with the providers of OERs that are provided for free for academic purposes, but for which these providers are going to pay in order to use them for lifelong learning activities or corporate training activities. In my sector, which is management education, we have companies that are working with us and with specific professors to design courses that are used in master's degrees for banking regulations, Basel III regulations, and how to turn that into the basis for a corporate training course for African banks wanting to reduce their risks and to be more compliant with IMF and World Bank requirements. So these corporations work quite well as long as the target subject and the target audience are very well defined. Generic content about generic digital skills, well, that doesn't work much. The people can find it for free on the internet, but they want to have value from specific content, and sometimes that can be linked with hybrid teaching, so, but not all the time. So working at the workplace on their own and having some hybrid events in order to to connect with their peers in other banks, that is something that we can build on something that has been designed originally as an open educational resource. So we need to have more businessmen understand that these are, there is a business model, and we need to academics to understand that requirements for corporate training can be more specific than what they are using in their master's degrees courses.
Robert, Chrissi, anything you would like to add to that?
Can I just add something to a point earlier made about absolutely the resources and how to create them potentially in teams? I think there is an widely unexplored, I think, opportunity also there to work with students also on that in partnership. And that cannot, it does not need to happen as an add-on. That can be part of the curriculum, because we learn a lot through making. You know, there's a whole theory behind this. It's experiential learning, but it's also the making process. And often academics or any educator feel under the pressure of, I need to create these resources. But actually, if we involve students in the making process itself, and that then counts towards assessment, for example, and creates a life of that assessment that lives on beyond the credits that somebody will get for their course, I think that might also increase not just capacity, but we might have further pioneers in open that will be our own students who will spread the word. And I agree with what Robert said also earlier about open is not the answer for everything. It's just one of the tools in our toolkit. And I think there needs to be a clear purpose and rationale for using it. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with you, Chrissi, about the involvement of students. I mentioned open pedagogy as for me the way to go. And what you mentioned are the perfect examples which fall under this umbrella of open pedagogy. One thing you can't ask for students is being unless they are students learning to become a teacher. But the average science student or the average math student, they can create artifacts. You can reuse maybe in other follow-up courses or so. But they don't have any knowledge about pedagogy, about didactics, and so on. And I guess there you should find a way. And I'm not so sure how it could be done in transforming those resources they create into actual courseware. This is why working in partnership will be valuable. Yeah, and then it will be really a collaboration, a co-creation, and not students creating something and then it's out in the open and then, then I agree.
If I could add something, because I hear that one of the most important words emerging from this discussion is collaboration and community, right? So teamwork in general. And I think that I will put Paula on the spot here a little bit, because she's a specialist in building communities, but also in sustaining communities, but because that's the next step. So Paula, could you talk a little bit to this idea of how important, what's the role of the community passion, probably also not only community, but also passion, because these communities are very often based on passion in building capacity around open educational resources. And I think that you can speak to your work with the NOL network.
Well, thank you. I think that everything is already in within the contribution of Chrissi, Jacques, and Robert together, because I was also writing down some keywords here. And what I see in the team working effort behind the capacity building actions is that they are fighting together against the inertia of the system. And we have to continue doing that, because at a certain point, the strength that we are putting in it all together will move the system forward. And this is, it's just a quantum of energy that we need to put on the floor. And I was thinking about what we do in the NOL while you were talking, and we are counting actually on the time and efforts of our members who are volunteering in doing their sometimes small part, sometimes very big part of the job to move things forward. And what we try to do as a practice is to create tools that can be easily adapted and reused, because we think about the time that people need to involve, but also we really put an effort in sharing the attitude behind it, because it's a good practice in itself. And a key to this is to consider open as an approach, not as opposed to close, but as an alternative in between others. And this works quite well, I think, for us. And Chrissi, you were asking what is their motivation? Well, in the NOL, the European Network of Open Education Librarians, we have librarians. So we can count, first of all, on their attitude to serve their stakeholders, serve students first, serve researchers, serve teachers. So this is what they do within the NOL. They just apply what they do on a daily basis elsewhere in their institutions, and then they convey their strength and their willing to help together. And that's why we can count on their contribution in the NOL. That's what moving us forward also, for example, for the toolkit of some tools that we offered actually now in 16 different languages. Can you imagine that? Librarians using their free time to work on this and providing very simple tools for others to be reused in order to advocate for the open education benefits for stakeholders. That's what we do. I don't know if I answered your question properly, Agata, but please go ahead in case.
No, I mean, absolutely. And I also see that, Robert, you put that you think collecting good examples can help a lot also. So yes, some kind of exchange, knowledge exchange, right?
Sure, that's what we do, with the other. Yeah. In the NOL, at least, we do that organizing webinars in between members who are sharing their knowledge and their experiences with others. And then we share the recordings openly with the public.
If I may also, because Paola, of course, you are speaking about a community of librarians. So I would actually like to ask our experts about how do you think libraries could support you in the implementation process of the UNESCO recommendation on OER? What could librarians do to make it easier for everyone?
I can start answering your question. I've mentioned some of these elements earlier. Librarians can have several roles in it, but I see, for instance, in this nursing project, but also in other projects, that within institutions, for sharing the process from creating learning materials to sharing it on an open license, is a process where the teacher, together with his support with the support staff, is creating those resources, which go to the librarian. The librarian checks it on the copyright issues, and when there are issues, give it back and with an advice how to advance. And when it is okay, they collect the metadata, the more content-specific metadata from the teacher, and add the more general metadata which to it. In the Netherlands, we have a national standard on metadata for educational resources, and then they upload it in the repository, which is also a national platform. And but they can also create this awareness among teachers, and that's a role which I think is very important, because for most teachers, also for commercial learning materials, librarians are the first persons they go to help them or to assist them in the process of buying, for giving information to the students and so on, and they can also point teachers towards open education resources and help them, for instance, in finding them or those kinds of efforts, which could also be a more advocating role instead of only a supportive role.
Chuck, would you like to go next, or?
Chrissi, please.
Would you like to go next, or?
Perhaps I will let you have the floor first, and
okay,
then.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll continue what Robert just started saying, maybe by bringing in a specific example of how the invaluable resource that librarians are, I think, could be useful. For example, universities in the UK at the moment, and I think it's beyond the UK, are very much into inclusive learning and teaching, and they talk often about decolonizing the curriculum or be anti-colonialist. So our own colleagues, and I think all of us at times struggle to find resources that are more inclusive and represent diverse views, and that includes academic papers and other resources from around the world, for example. So in this case, I think working with specialist librarians, I think, would be invaluable and a time saver as well.
I think what you said, Chrissi, is very valuable content-wise and very important, because it helps us address these challenges that we face in our higher education institution. I would also add another role for the librarians about interoperability, interconnection of repositories. We have diverse repositories with different languages, different cultural contexts. And perhaps there should be not tighter, but more seamless integration of these repositories, not tighter in a way that is centralized top down, but somewhat easing navigation. And perhaps one community that I find not very much integrated into the open education process, because, well, we can find them boring at the time. They're about semantics. It's the people who are dealing with ISO, with the SEND workshop, with IMS, all these standardization bodies that compete among themselves and spend more time discussing semantics than what we all really do. But in a way, it would be nice to that librarians can bring them into the discussion, because you're probably best suited to discuss with them, with your understanding of metadata of and all these related standards. So you had long standing experience with standards. So that would be something very valuable you could bring to the other communities, I think.
Thank you so much. Paula, I thought that you had a question, so I'm just calling on you.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Now, I was wondering if you have any small idea, very small steps that we can all embrace in order to implement the strategies to move forward in this, because to build capacity, you said that we need, and I completely agree, cultural and legal adaptations. And this takes time and also a lot of attention. It's very time consuming. We've been through this together, so in different projects, I think. And this is something that is not always considered when you think about a new project or a new content to be developed and then shared. We are all used to use English, and thanks to English for being our lingua franca. But then it's very important for us to think at the local context in order to move forward. So do you have any suggestion or any strategy to make this easier to do?
Do you mean to adapt resources into other languages other than English?
Yeah, not only to translate them, but also keep an eye, yes, on the legal issues and on the cultural side of it.
So it would be a localization, isn't it?
Yes.
Not a,
yes,
your translation.
Yeah.
I mean, my suggestion, my undergraduate degree is in translation. And I think there is a, I don't know where we are with the collaboration with departments of translation across the world, because every country will have at least one department, and the one in Greece is actually in Corfu, which I've finished. So how can we potentially work much closer directly with translation departments in different universities across the world, and again involve all stakeholders, including students, in that process? That would be my suggestion. I don't know what Jack and Robert would say.
Well, involving students in translation issues, it could be maybe a wonderful task for students who are studying the language. Like the French students at studying French language, translating English OER into French, or English or French OER into Dutch, or something like this. I have no experience with this. I like the idea, but I don't know if it has already been done in the Netherlands, actually.
I also like the idea very much. The issue is how do we make it scalable, and perhaps not yet already, but perhaps in the future, some forms of artificial intelligence can help us shorten the time needed to adapt and translate. There was a few years ago an Erasmus Plus submission by ICD with a number of proposals which dealt with the cultural and linguistic adaptation. Well, fortunately, it was not accepted. And I say fortunately because I'm not sure we could have solved it at the time. But it's an area where we should move forward as fast as we can.
Thank you so much. I'm aware of time here. We have 5 minutes to go. I hate to interrupt the discussion here, but I wanted to ask specifically to the audience, are there any other questions that you are just dying to ask to our experts? Now is the time. So please don't be shy. Please go ahead.
Can also be a discussion between Ristretto and Happy for our Greek colleagues.
Absolutely. I think that everyone is shy at this point. That's completely fine. Thank you again for the fantastic discussion. I think that first of all, I am particularly pleased with is the fact that first of all, it was a discussion, which was great. Second of all, we actually named several, little steps, but actual tangible steps that can be taken by pretty much anybody in order to work on this capacity building. So I like this practical approach very much. That was very much my goal here also, to just talk about practice more than theory here. So thank you so much for that. One thing to mention is perhaps that, as I said at the beginning, this is a series of meetings. So we will continue. And the next one, the next Open Education Cafe, will be actually held in person, which is quite a feast. So I really would encourage all of you to come. This will be held at the OE Global Conference, which is coming. And Paula, now please correct me if I'm wrong, at the end of May, I think. right?
Yes, yes, yes.
Exactly.
So 23, 25 of May.
Absolutely. Okay, great. Fantastic. So I'm putting two more links to our chat here, which hopefully will be useful for you. If you haven't registered to OE Global yet, please do so, because among other wonderful events, there will be also Open Education Café there with more open education champions there. And I also wanted to draw your attention to one more thing that NOL is doing. So the network that that Paola is working on. So before each of our Open Education Café episodes, we actually release a short podcast in which members of the NOL network talk about one of the action areas. So we have now released the first one in a series. We call them OE Bites, because they are delicious bites of open education that you can easily digest. So I encourage you to also look at these little podcasts. The next one will be coming probably in mid-May, just before the event that we will have in person in Nantes, right? So a very beautiful city, actually one of my favorites in France. So I encourage you to go. And thank you so very much to Robert, Jacques, Chrissi. Thank you so much for the discussion. And I hope that we will have a chance to talk more during any other open education cafes, so that we can all enjoy our coffee and great conversation. Thank you all very much, and see you in Nantes. Thank you.
See you.
Goodbye, bye, everyone.
Thank you. Ciao.
Bye, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.